Good afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, how you doing?
Great.
Wasn't it a fantastic day today?
Yes.
Yes, it is days like this that made me realize that I did the right choice so many years ago to go to sea, because just with a flat sea, almost like a lake, and the sun and 24, 25 degrees, upper 70s, following winds and following seas, doesn't get any better than this. So thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule, coming here and listening a little bit to me when I talk about the different ports that we have been to, and a little bit about the ports that we are going to go to. So let me just start up the... It's amazing how fast those 20 minutes goes on the screensaver here. There we go. So, this is the third seminar that I had. Before this, I had one where we talked about the building of the harmony of the seas and discussed quite a bit of that. And then we had famous sailors and navigators. And now we're going to the different ports. Big ports, small ports. And I'm going to talk a little bit about them and a little bit about how we did the maneuvers in some of the ports. So, of course, this is Western Europe. And we started in St. Nazaire, which I will talk about, and then we ended up going to Southampton for a couple of cruises out of England. Next one was Rotterdam, followed by, well, I see that we lost out on Vigo, but that's up in the northern part of Spain here. Then we went into Barcelona, and we went to Palma, where you all have been. We did Marseille, La Spezia, Civitavecchia, Naples, and of course we did Malaga as well. This is the route in the Western Med here that we have been doing for about 5 months. We started with these runs in the beginning of June, and we've been doing pretty much the same thing until you guys came on board. Not necessarily in the area of this map here. We went from Barcelona to Palma, then to Marseille, La Spezia, down to Rome, to Naples, but then we went in through the Bonifacio Strait here, where we have Corsica to the north and Sardinia on the south. So this is just an advertising clip, so that's not really how we did it. Saint Nazaire is a small village up on the northwest coast of France, and that's where the harmony was built. And there are a couple of things that Saint Nazaire is famous for, and the biggest one is probably the yard. It is now called STX France, but when we started building ships here, 150 years ago, not we as in Royal, but the people that were there, it's called the Chantiers de l'Atlantique. So that means the yards of the Atlantic. And they have been building a lot of ships over the years, and during World War II, it was one of the big German naval bases, and the docks that we used to build this ship was used in those times for big battleships, and would even be possible to cater for the Bismarck. Never ended up there, but it was still the size of it. This picture is from when we took the ship out on the 15th of May, and this is the outfitting dock where we were in at. The distance between the edges of the dock and the ship was 35 meters if we did it the right way. And to take out the ship and bagging it out into the river Loire, that was fantastic. And we had a bit of help with the tugboats all around. And some of them we had hooked up just in case we needed them, but we have so much power on this ship, so we didn't really use them. It was just there in case something happened. This one is a little bit earlier in the year. You see that we still have a lot of work to do in comparison to how the ship looks today. There are no lifeboats on the sides, and a lot of the outfitting part is still to come. And of course, we have the missing abyss at the bottom there. Saint Nazaire, La Brule, and Pornichet has a fantastic beach. It's one of the best beaches in Europe, arguably. It's a long, I had the pleasure to live really close to it, so I saw it during the winter. So I didn't spend a lot of time on the beach. And then in the old sub pens, where the submarine base was, they still have them. They haven't been able to take them down. I know that the Allied forces tried to bomb them to pieces, but they didn't manage to do that because they were so solidly built. So one of them have made into a museum, and here you see a French submarine called the Espadon, and that is part of the museum that they have built there. And it's mostly about ocean liners, because Transatlantic has been building ocean liners and cruise ship for quite a while. The next port of call was Southampton, where we were in a few times, and we also started our maiden voyage from Southampton. And that is a historical port. A lot of the Royal Navy ships have been based out of the Solent and Spithead between the Isle of Wight, Portsmouth, and Southampton. And here is one of the pictures of when we came in, the first first call that we had there. And it was a beautiful morning, very little wind, and it was a nice feeling to take the ship into this historical part of the world. And that is seen from the other side. It's a beautiful sight, isn't it? Yes. Very happy to get the ship in there. Then, of course, we have some of the museums there. It's an old fighter pilot plane from World War II. And, of course, we have another famous thing here, the stadium, St. Mary's, where the Southampton's playing. And, of course, one of the most famous players there is Matthew Le Tessier, that most of you that are interested in European football would know about. And there's one of the other museums here where you have the Sea City Museum. There's also a big green garden. Of course, England has its different parks, and they also have that in Southampton. The next port of call that we went to, so that was our real first port of call. Southampton, of course, is a real port of call as well, but it was a turnover, and we had that as a home base. So Rotterdam was the first port where we went into when we were not returning. A few things. It's one of the most busiest ports in the world. They have about 300,000 movements per year. So it's a long journey. It's about 2.5 hours from pilot all the way up until we were docked. And you can see, basically, downtown. Here's the Port Authority of Rotterdam, and here is a bridge, so we couldn't go any further up than what we were, absolutely at the edge. One of the famous areas of Rotterdam is the Markthal, which is a very special market, and have some offices and some places where you live, so residential areas, and couple of different areas. And then the Zoo of Rotterdam is one of the most famous in Europe, and it opened in 1875, and it's considered to be a very high-class zoo. And of course, another football stadium where Feyenoord is playing, and you will see a couple of them more coming in here, because sport is so big, especially the football, in the places where we ended up. Then we have the Rotterdam steamship, which was one of our competitor ships, of course. It has now been a hotel for the last 6 years, but it is one of the steamships that they docked there, and to keep the legacy of that other cruise line, which you can't imagine which one it is. Anybody knows? Holland America. Then we went to Barcelona, and of course this is a world city. And everybody knows about the architecture and all the different things that is going on there with Gaudi, this famous architect that was very busy in this area of the world. This is the port of Barcelona, and we were coming in here with the in the southern entrance. Here's the north entrance. It's way too small for us to go in. And here's some breakwater, and here's another breakwater. So we need to go in here, and we can get quite a bit of northerly current as we were coming in here. So the speed what we wanted to have was between 8 and 10 knots as we were coming in here. Then we needed to slow down. If we were at 10 knots here, we needed to slow down relatively fast because there's a tanker pier here that we needed to pass with not more than 6 knots. And then coming up here and docking starboard side alongside. So since we were starboard side alongside, we then had to turn around to go out. So we were reversing, and many of you saw that when we left on the 23rd. We were coming in here, and then we turned around in this turning circle and came out again here to get out to sea. So this is the famous Sagrada Familia that was designed by Gaudi here. And he started to build that in 1882. And anybody knows when it's ready? Not yet, yes, in 10 years. The plan is to have it ready in 2026. So you can still see the cranes that are here building on it. I passed by about 10 years ago, and it was a fantastic experience to see it, but I don't know how many hundreds of millions of euro that they put in to build it. It's a fantastic experience to see that. And of course, another football stadium, Barcelona's home stadium, is Nou Camp, which is the biggest stadium in Europe. It holds just under 100,000 people. And one of the pictures from the harbor in Barcelona, you can see all the architecture. It's a lot of beautiful buildings, and everywhere is just very, very neatly made. This is the Palau de la Música, which is about 100 years old or so, and is one of the UNESCO World Heritage Sites, where they will play, obviously will play music and having concerts. Then we have the Gothic quarters, which was not built in the Gothic area, but it still has a lot of labyrinths that ends up on small little squares and openings. Nice place. Palma de Mallorca, we've all been there, we've all seen it. It's a large tourist island, but also a lot of expats that live there. The weather is great and the climate is fantastic. So there are a lot of Northern European people that move to Palma to stay there. This is how we come in with the ship. About 10 knots here, making a big turn. And when we pass between the breakwater here, we have about 6 knots. And then we come in, slow down, and we dock port side alongside. Then when we are done for the day, we back out and we turn in this turning circle here. Don't turn that much because as you see, it's only about 45 degrees or so that we need to go, and then we come out. The weather here is usually nice. We have, most of the time, we have southwesterly winds, so it comes this way. Once in a blue moon, you get an easterly wind that you would have to be careful so you don't set up too much into this area because then it can be a little shallow. The cathedral is very obvious. You see that all, from all over the place, the Cathedral de Sceaux. It was finished about 400 years ago in the 1600s, and it took about 400 to build it. The long investments of the people that were building these places. And this is up on the northwestern part of Mallorca. Beautiful limestone creations here. And of course it's far away from all the tourists. So if you would go back to Palma, you would go up there, it would find secluded areas all over. And this is a picture of Paseo de Born, which is one of the famous streets there with cafes and shops all over the place. Don't know if any of you had the chance to go there, but it's a nice little area. Tourist, but still nice. And then we have the caves of the dragons, or the drac. I don't know how it's really pronounced in Spanish, but means the dragon caves. And it's about 2.5 kilometers long caves that you can go around with boats and see the different formations of the stone, how it's created. Then we have Marseille, which is one of the largest cities in France. Has a lot of history. It is one of the earliest settlements in Europe, and beautiful historical place. When we're coming in with the ship, we come up. This is a long breakwater, and here's the dock where we're going to. We're coming up this way, and then we turn the ship so we back in. And it's approximately 1 mile that we are backing, and then we look starboard side alongside here. The reason for that is that we have very high winds here from time to time. It's called the Mistral. And the Mistral comes roughly from this direction. So we want to have the bow up into the wind, if we get it. And another reason why we do the turn outside and back in is that it's very tight to turn here. And as many of you know, the ship is built for being starboard side alongside, so we prefer to be starboard as much as possible. Should something happen when we are in here and we get a lot of wind, we are in a really tight place. If we get a lot of wind when we are here and we are facing out, we can always just put the pedal to the metal and go straight out. So there's a lot of things that are coming into place of doing it this. And then when we're done for the day, we head out and then we turn around and we head to the next port. Here we see the Notre Dame de la Garde, and it is built on the highest point of Marseille. And here you see Chateau d'If, which is, I will talk a little bit more about that later, but you see this from a different angle here. This is one of the famous national parks, and it looks absolutely fantastic. It is about 200 square mile, and it was relatively new, developed into being a national park, because they wanted to keep the settlement here. And as you can see, fantastic water and small little beaches that are coming in. So this is just outside of Marseille. And this is the old port. And that was created about 600 years before Christ. And as I said, it's one of the oldest settlements, and it has been conquered by a lot of different cultures, so it has a lot of different influences that is in the area of Marseille. Right now it's mostly pleasure yachts, and cars are not allowed to drive in here in the center, and there's a lot of coffee shops and small little stores, etc., restaurants. And then, of course, we have the Chateau d'If. The castle here that turned into be a prison. And do you know why it's so famous?
Count of Monte Cristo.
Count of Monte Cristo, yes. The famous novel by Alexandre Dumas, where the Count of Monte Cristo ended up, or before he was the Count of Monte Cristo, he was in prison here, falsely accused of treason. And it's nice to go through there. We don't go in the sound between the island and Marseille with this ship, but we did with the anthem. I passed through there. We are a little bit too big to do it. And then this is the Musem, which is a celebration to all the different civilizations that have been around in this area. And it's just a few years old, and it shows the European and all over the Mediterranean cultures that we have. The next protocol is La Spezia, and a lot of people don't really know about La Spezia, but it's an old famous naval port. It was Napoleon that decided that the navy should have a base there, and Cinque Terre, of course everybody knows about that, Porto Venere, and it is so close to Florence and Pisa. When we are entering, this is a breakwater that they put in to protect the naval base, so the ships that were attacking wouldn't have any space to go in. And then they had forts here in both areas so they could cover the two entrances. And we're coming in here and going up in this small narrow channel and coming up here. And as we are passing here, it's only 40 meters clearance on each side. And then we dock starboard side here. When we leave at night, we are backing out, and the later on in the season, the darker it got. So the last couple of months, we haven't had any daylight when we are leaving. So it's really tight in this area. We back out, turn the ship around, and then we get out here with a nice and slow speed before we are past the shallow areas here. All of this area here is the Navy base, still is a Navy base. I know that there are some forces that would like to build cruise ship piers here, open up, so you would have a wider area, put some cruise ships in there, but at this stage it's still covered by the Navy. And here you can see, as we're coming in here and passing, this is the area where it is so narrow, and then we're dock here, here's the Navy base. And here, of course, is a picture of one of the villages in Qingtao, so of course means the five lands. And it's Monterosso, Vernazza, Corniglia, Manarola, and Riaggio Maggiore. Now, how is that for Italian pronunciation? Of course, this is also another UNESCO World Heritage site. And you can only go with train, boats, or by feet. There are no cars allowed in the different villages there. This is just outside of Porto Venere, and this is the Festa della Madonna Bianca. And once a year, the whole village of Porto Venere, and of course this this church that is to Madonna Bianca is lit up by candlelight, and it happens in August. And I was fortunate when I was here in La Spezia with the Anthem of the Seas last year in August. It was on a Saturday, and I saw all the lights as it was going on. So it was quite an amazing sight. Then, of course, it's close to Pisa, the Leaning Tower. And that's quite old, and it's falling over so much that it actually had to be stabilized. Otherwise, we wouldn't have any leaning tower or pizza, we would just have a ruin out of it. So they had to secure it, so it still stays in the same angle here. And of course, it's close to Florence as well, or Firenze, as is the Italian name for Florence. A lot of things have happened there. There's a lot of old libraries, a lot of beautiful churches and buildings. But of course, it was the Medici family that started their banking business there. And that is the banking system that most of the world is using as of today. They started in Florence. And this is Santa Maria del Fiore, which was completed in 1463. And at that stage, it was the highest built building and the biggest building that had been built. Of course, next one being Rome, the Eternal City. A lot of things that you can say about Rome. It's a big city and it has a lot of culture, of course. A lot of the highlights that I'm going to show you about a little bit later is just things that we maybe don't even realize how much impact they have, and when we see them, when we realize what it is, we know and recognize it. But Rome is not the port where we go to. That is called Civitavecchia, which is about 45 minutes with car, maybe an hour away from Rome. And we do a very similar maneuver as we do in Marseille. We come in here, we turn the ship, and we back in, and we dock starboard side here. It's also about a mile. And here we also can have quite strong winds, so that's the same reason we want to have the bow out. If we winds would pick up rapidly, and we would be able to drive out. Another option is to go in, turn here, but it's tighter, and then dock here. One of the times we had to go in and dock on this side of the pier because it was occupied on this side, and then we turned here. But otherwise, all the maneuvers that I have made with this ship has been on the outside. And in the evening then, of course, we just let all the lines come off the pier, and then we are driving the ship out through the channel there. And it's also about a mile long. Colosseum. About 80,000 people could watch all the gladiators that were there to fight between themselves and animals and whatnot. And of course, they all saluted the Caesar with, we that are about to die salute you. Now that's a tough call to go in there knowing what's going to happen to you. So a lot of big things, dramatic, very graphic. Things were going on in the Colosseum. One of the most famous fountains in the world, the Trevi Fountain, is about 350 years old, and the style is Baroque, and very romantic place, of course, as many of the other places around in Rome. And here we have the Forum, which is ruins that shows from many different times. It's not only from one time that you can see when you go around here. It's mostly governmental buildings, or they use them for governmental functions. And here, of course, we have the Vatican, which is a city within, or a state within the city, St. Peter's Square, very famous. And the Vatican State has about 840 inhabitants. And then we have the Spanish Step. Anybody that knows how many there are? I know. Anybody would like to know? Okay, so take a guess then. 103? 200 too many. 135 steps to go up there. And you will feel them, I promise you. Every one of them when you go up. And then we have the Pantheon here, which is built about 100 years before Christ. And that was built by the Emperor Hadrian, and it is still in use, so it must be one of the oldest buildings that are in use. And then of course we have Naples, famous for a lot of different things. Vesuvius, Pompeii, Capri, and of course pizza. And when we are coming into Naples with a ship, we come in this way. And there are a couple of ways of doing it. This is where we are docked. So this is actual a screenshot of when we were there. We can turn right inside. Here is a breakwater. Here's another one. So as soon as we come in, we can turn here and back in. Or we can come in here and turn to the port. But every now and then, they have a Mediterranean docked ship here. Mediterranean dock means that you have the stern against the pier, and you dock with anchors. So if you have a ship that is sticking out here, 150 meters, it makes it very tight for us to turn in this area. So the last couple of times, we had to turn here and back in. I prefer to come in here, turn to port, and back in. It's usually very protected from all areas, except from the south or southeast. Second to last cruise that we were in Naples, we had up to 50 knots of wind when we were leaving. 15 minutes before departure, we had 50 knots. When we took the lines, we had 27. When the stern passed the end of the pier, we had 40. And by then, it's too late to do anything else. We had ship docked right next to us. We cannot do anything but to go. So we had enough power, more than enough, to withstand 50 knots of wind as we were coming out here and turning to the south and heading into the wind. So the wind was coming from this direction. So that made me really happy, I must say. It was not so nice when it happened, but afterwards it gave me a lot of confidence in what the harmony can do. This, of course, is a picture of the Vesuvius that was the main reason, or the reason why Pompeii is so famous, because it had a big eruption and then it covered Pompeii here with quite a few meters of ash. And this is Pompeii, so all of this area was covered by ash. And then, of course, they have made the excavations and taking out everything, so now you can come in and see all the different, and it's well preserved, so you can see how people were living there 2,000 years ago. And then, of course, we have Capri, which is an island just south of Naples, and famous for its building, beautiful place, been a tourist place for many, many years. Hundreds of years, centuries, decades, even millenniums, because that's been for several thousand years. And then we have a lot of culture as well in Naples. And this is the San Severo, which is a historical center here, where a lot of the artwork is. It's maybe a little bit difficult for you to see here, but it's just a very typical of the area here in Naples, over there. And then, of course, most spread around the world, the pizza. And that was said to have started in 1889, and it was to commemorate the visit of Queen Margherita. So that was the first pizza, Margherita. Then Malaga, as we were last week, it's also a big tourist and expat area. People are coming there to have a nice climate, live close to the beach, to the ocean, year around, nice weather, and favorable living conditions and standards. This is where we were docked, along the pier, and then you see some of the hotels, and it spreads out for quite a while here, all the different tourist areas. But also, you can't really see where we were docked here now. This is the inner port. So we are docked somewhere outside there. There's a famous automobile and fashion museum in Malaga. And here we have the let's see if I can pronounce it better, the Alcazaba, which is a fort that is well preserved and that is overlooking the city. And then we have the Castillo de Gibralfaro, which is more of a routine and it's closer to the port here. A lot of famous pictures have been taken there, a lot of selfies in recent years overlooking the port, and of course we were docked in this side here, so probably we have a few hashtag harmony of the seas that with a selfie and the ship in the background from last week. And here we have the La Concepción Jardín Botánico, which is a 23 hectare botanical garden, which is about 150-160 years old, which is containing flowers and fauna from five different continents here. So it's not only sun and beach and that kind that you maybe think of when you think about the sun coast here in Malaga. And then of course we're coming across the Atlantic, and we have a few places over where we will visit. Obviously the ship hasn't been here, but our sister ship, the Allure of the Seas, has been in Nassau, and this is when she's leaving in the port of Nassau. Nassau is an old pirate haven, and there's a nice pirate TV series called Black Sails. If you would like to see, then they have built up a place that's supposed to be like Nassau a few hundred years ago. Maybe not be the same, but it's a good series if you want interested to see about what Nassau looked like a few hundred years ago. A lot of beaches, a lot of shopping, of course, in the Caribbean. And the next port is St. Thomas and Charlotte Amalie, which is considered to be the shopping capital of the Caribbean. Of course, it has a lot of beaches, Megan's Bay, of course we have, and also the Mahogany Run golf course. But crystal clear water with beaches and shopping is what St. Thomas is about. St. Martin, we also go to, which I think will come a little bit later. Labadee was the next one here, our own private part of Haiti. And this is also then on the Allure, and coming down the zip line. I've never done it yet, don't like heights, but somebody's got to do it. The same with the Abyss on board here. I've done it once. I was very happy doing it, especially when I came out at the bottom. And then, of course, as I said, we have St. Martin, which is a mix of Europe and the Caribbean, with the French and the Dutch port. Now the Dutch port has become its own country, but of course you still have the Dutch inheritance around them. We have the different beaches, of course, Oriental Beach, famous for its different cultures as well. And then we have the Maho Beach, where we have the airplanes that are flying in over the beach and you get blown away by them. So on. Well, that's a little bit about the port. Of course, I cannot go too much into detail because then you will sit here tomorrow. But if you have any questions, we have a couple of the cruise director staff that are around here in the hall, and you can ask questions. And I kindly ask you that you stick to the subject about the port that we have been to or that we're going to. And we will, in 2 days, we will have something called a Captain's Corner, where we open up for any questions. But if you have anything outside of this, then I would kindly ask you to hold that until we open up for the Captain's Corner. First one out here, Winston Hill.
Hello, Captain. This is my very first cruise. And I have to say that I am having an unbelievable time. Your staff, especially that fantastic cruise director of yours, is just incredible. First cruise, it's brilliant! Thank you, Captain!
Thank you very much. Really appreciate it. What's your name, sir?
My name is Leroy, and I come to you from Boca Raton, Florida.
Leroy from Boca Raton, fantastic. I'll buy you a drink later.
Thank you.
Thank
Selfie! Thank you, Captain!
Thank you, Leroy.
Here's me.
I've
never done this before.
Leroy is world famous. Okay.
Captain, could you share with us some stories or your interaction through these different ports that the role of the harbor pilot plays?
Absolutely. The harbor pilot is a locally known person that comes on board with a small little boat, and he climbs up on a rope ladder, and he comes up to the bridge, and then he helps us with a few things. One is that he always speaks the language, not necessarily that he speaks my language, but he speaks the local language at least. Depending on what part of the world you're in, it's a little bit different. The European pilots are varying quite a lot. We have had really good cooperation with the pilots in Marseille. They're really good. I've been up to their station and I have done simulations with different wind conditions, and they have invited me for that. In La Spezia, also very professional, very good, solid. Their stroller comes on board so they can check one on each side, because it is so tight, as I mentioned. Other places, maybe not so much interacting with us. For example, the day when we had so much wind, the pilot was gone before the stern had passed the pier. So it goes a little bit up and down. In North America, they usually are more active and more helping us. In Europe, they never get the con of the ship. Actually, they did in Southampton, and they did in Rotterdam. But the docking itself, the maneuver to the pier, is always done by us. In North America, they get the con. In the Caribbean, I don't see them getting the con either. So they help us, and we help them. They know the port, we know the ship. So it's a combination there. It's a teamwork most of the time.
Hi, Captain. I'm Ellen from Surprise, Arizona. My question is, with the latest hurricane going through Haiti, did Labadee suffer any damage?
Yes, it did suffer some damage, not to the piers, but it did suffer some damage. We have a relief program, so we're taking a lot of the support material with the ships that are going there from Florida. We take them over, so we're expecting to take as well when we go to Labadee. We load it on board in Fort Lauderdale, and then we drop it off in Labadee for them then to distribute, even as far south as Port-au-Prince. If you hold up your arm a little bit longer here, so they can go to the next one immediately. Sunil first.
Hi. I was wondering, after the winter, will you do reposition and come back to Europe and do the same ports as you did this year?
If the Harmony is doing it?
Right.
No.
Oh, you'll stay in North America?
Yes.
Or you just do the Caribbean?
Yes. Okay. As far as we have had any plans, the Harmony will stay based out of Port Everglades and doing East and Western in different configurations, but East and Western Caribbean cruises for the foreseeable future. Next year, the Freedom of the Seas will come to Europe and do very similar cruises to what we have. Not exactly, but very similar cruises. The year after, it's not being released. We have a sister ship to the Harmony that is coming out, let's call it, towards the late part of first quarter or early second quarter, maybe, somewhere like that. She also is built in St. Nazaire, so who knows where she's going to go. Maybe. We don't know yet. Or maybe somebody knows but cannot say it here today.
How much larger is the Harmony over the Allure?
30 centimeters.
How many meters?
0.3.
What's that, about a foot?
Yes. At least for me, it's a foot. And of course, she's a bit wider up in the superstructure, so that's why the gross tonnage is about 1,800 tons difference. But the length is 30 centimeters.
Captain, I'm Ian from Ottawa, and I'm curious to know when you meet your emergency stop at a small island on our way. Did you actually dock, or did somebody come out to the ship, or how did that work?
No, we didn't dock. The port of Madeira, I don't think that they can handle us, so we stopped about a mile south of the breakwater. Here in the front again.
Yeah,
John from Tampa. Would you ever want a tender if you can't, let's say, a ship is in your spot, or do you kick it out? How does that work?
Yes, the ship is not built for tender operation, and unless we get a much better system than what any ship has today, I think it would be really difficult, because we can have big tenders, we can have small tenders, but that doesn't take away the fact that we have 6,500 guests, let's say 5,500 of them would like to go off the ship between 9 and 10:30. So there is no way, even if we would have 8 tender boats docked at the same time, we wouldn't be able to get everybody off in that ratio that you would be happy with. And then, of course, the opposite way to bringing everybody back, if we have a 6 o'clock departure between 3:45 and 5:10, everybody would want to come back. So that's hard with a big ship like this. We do it with the quantum class, but it needs to be really well executed then to get the numbers. And the best tender operation that I've seen was out of Cabo San Lucas with the Mariner, when we had a platform and we could have 2 tender boats at the same time. And we had 12 or 14 tender boats. They took 50 people each, but they were just going like a conveyor belt. And we were on dynamic positioning quite close to the port. So they just went really, really fast and the lines never stopped. So count down 50, okay, 50, they go. The last one was on that. And then they take off, a new one comes in, and then we count 50, and then we stop, and then they do the same. So it was really, really efficient. You can do it with maybe 2,500 people, but doing it with 5.5, it's tough. So, really long answer to your question, but no. Yeah? No. Yes, no. It's planned years and years in advance. Even though it has not been released where we will go in 2018, I'm sure that the spots have already been booked maybe 2, 3, 4 years in advance. And in some areas, our company has a strong presence. In other areas, we don't have such a strong presence. And then we get the third choice, maybe. Hopefully not, but that's really how it works with the different communities.
Hi, Captain Anderson. I'm Bill from Fort Lauderdale. I just had a quick question about the timing that you pick to go into the port. Is that chosen by you or is that set by someone else? Because I'm just curious. I know we're supposed to come in around 5 a.m. on Saturday morning. Was it ever chosen or possible to go in later so that people in Fort Lauderdale can see the ship coming in?
Yes, they have golden opportunities to see us when we leave. Yes, because we have a lot of things that's going on that day, so we need the time, and we're probably going to come in even earlier than that, but that is the official arrival time for us. Sometimes it's influenced by us on board, but the deployment people are the ones that are really saying, and there's a lot of things to do to take into consideration. Daylight, can we operate when it's dark? Different tours available, the length of the stay, if we have to go early to reach the next port, which one has the best or is giving you the most. For example, when we leave San Juan and go to Labadee, it's really hard to leave San Juan later than 2 o'clock in the afternoon, depending on which ship we have, even maybe 1 o'clock, in order to get to Labadee the next day. And therefore, we choose Labadee, because we cannot come into Labadee at 12 o'clock lunchtime, then we might as well skip it. So we need to be there at 9 o'clock at the latest in order to give you what we would like to offer to you. So there are a lot of things that comes into play when it comes to the port times.
Yeah, I'm David from Orlando. I know that we're supposed to meet up with the other 2 sister ships on Friday afternoon. Do we have any more details about that, about the time and where we're going to be in the 3? Will it be to our starboard or to our port?
Yes.
Can you elaborate on, give us a little more detail on that?
I understand you would love that, yes. Absolutely. We're going to have the 2 ships on the port side. We will be the closest to land, if you call it that way. Then we will have Allure, and then we will have Oasis furthest away from us. So the three sisters in age, one after the other. And it will be in the afternoon, as you said, somewhere between 4 and 5 or so. And obviously then we will be facing south, all of us. So on the port side would be the best way to view them. If you want to see Fort Lauderdale, you stay on the starboard side.
Captain, the first time my wife and I sailed into Jamaica, we sailed into Ocho Rios, which is where all the attractions are. The last time we sailed, we went into Falmouth, which I understand was built at the insistence of Royal Caribbean. Yet, it's 30 miles away from all the attractions. What happened? Or why was that done?
Well, I haven't been to Jamaica for I don't know how many years. So I cannot answer you why it happened. Dunn's River Falls, I believe, is pretty much between Ocho Rios and Montego Bay. So that shouldn't really affect the distance so it depends a little bit on what kind of different attractions that you're after, but I'm not at all an expert in Jamaican geography and where the different things are located. The Falmouth was purpose-built for this class of ships, which obviously Ocho Rios and Montego Bay isn't. I would probably say that it would be a better port for us to go to rather than the distances and attractions, because if don't know if any of these ships have been into those, it would be really tight for these class of ships to go into those areas. I understand that this is not at all answering your question, but there might be a little bit of at least background to why. I hope we have at least one more, because that was not so nice for me to end up with a question that I don't have an answer to. Who's driving the boat, Captain?
No.
Anybody? All right. There's one over there.
Do you have backup mirrors to go out, cameras to get out backwards?
Yes, ma'am, we do. It's called CCTV. It's internal on the TV. You might have seen one of these little mushrooms in your cabin. But yes, we do have TVs, but also when we are turning and backing, we always have officers on the bow and on the stern that we are in constant radio communication with. So we have visual of the officers, we have our electronic charge, and we also have the TV with the cameras that we see. So we have three different systems that we are working with, and they all need to match up.
Captain, how much horsepower does it take to push this ship through the ocean? Or does it not have to do with horsepower? But I'm just trying to get an idea how much power is necessary to push this.
Probably one. Yeah, about 1 horsepower. It will take a long time to get to move anywhere, but but yeah. No, I would think so. Maybe a couple of hundred, maybe, to get it to move. Yes, I would think so.
What's your normal cruising speed is?
Now we have about 20 knots of speed, or so 19.5. Yes. Or I did not hear your question, or.
Yeah, I'm trying to find out.
Please speak into the microphone so I can hear what you're saying.
This ship is so huge. How much horsepower does it take to push it at its normal cruising speed?
At its normal cruising speed, yes. This one we have now, one big and two small. So that's about 18.5 plus 28. So is it like 42? 42 megawatts, which we're using now to get the speed. on what we have, but just to get it to move, maybe a couple of hundred horsepower. Obviously, that would be very cool. All right, last one up there.
Hello, Captain. My name is James. I'm from Ireland. In your sailing experience, or your sailing days, what was the most difficult port that you had to come into and fight?
Well, I would say that the tightest port, given the circumstances and the size of the ship, was La Spezia in Italy, because it is so tight. And the corner of the pier, if you would come too close to that, it's like a can opener. So you really need to stay away from it. And then on the other side, you risk running aground if you come too close. But the good thing with La Spezia is that there's very seldom any wind. It's very protected. And that's what Napoleon saw when he wanted to build a naval base there, because it was so protected from most winds. Once in a blue moon you get winds, but then I wouldn't go in there. More than 25 knots of wind, I wouldn't go into La Spezia. But it's very, very seldom. 25 knots of wind we have quite regularly in Civitavecchia, which is just a few hours south, because it is so open. But La Spezia there is tight. I would say wind-wise, the most difficult is probably Marseille, because you get so high winds from the Mistral that's coming over the mountains. And if you're not in the right place before the wind comes, you end up quickly being in a bad situation. But what they are doing in Marseille is they actually opened up, so they cut away about 50 meters of their breakwater entrance, as opposed to Civitavecchia, where they built it more closed. For whatever reason. But Marseille is very proactive of wanting to have big ships and making it in a better way. 10 years from now, how will it look? And then they are starting with the plans. So they are really in a proactive state of mind. Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for coming here today. It isn't only me that is here now today that has prepared this. We have a tech team, we have lighting, we have sound, and we have the man behind this presentation. It is a very, very talented cadet that works up on the bridge, and he's over here, and his name is Ben. And he's the man behind this presentation. He has a fantastic career with us in the future. Right? Should you give him? Yeah, he knows we're going to.